We shall move on to the next topic regarding cardiology by Dr. Meenakshi. She has completed her MBBS from Madurai Medical College and MD Pediatrics from Stanley Medical College in Chennai, and has finished her DM Cardiology in Madras Medical College, and completed her fellowship in Interventional Cardiology in a Triple M Hospital, Chennai. She is an enthusiastic, patient-centered cardiologist with good diagnostic imaging and interventional skills with more than 5 years of experience. And she's very enterprising and seeking new frontiers in the field of interventional cardiology. She has been awarded the Torrent Young Scholar Award in 2014 and Best Case Presenter in Professor Rajendra Tandon's update in SIMS Hospital, Chennai, and Best Case Presenter Prize in PG Update, Madras Medical Mission Hospital. And she has authored a few books, especially to mention is Choosing Fibrinolytics in STEMI, Economics Over Efficacy, and Extracorporeal Membrane Oxygenation, that is ECMO, for day-to-day practice. She is a member of the Cardiological Society of India and many other societies. And she will be talking to us regarding the heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, diagnosis and treatment. This is a very common and intriguing topic, how to treat and how to go about, whether to treat or not, and how to manage. I think Dr. Meenakshi will throw us some light regarding this. Over to you, madam. Dr. Meenakshi? Yes.
I couldn't share my screen.
Below there are the options. Yes, yes,
ma'am. Can you see me?
Yes, yes, yes. You can switch on the slideshow.
Yeah. Good evening, all senior colleagues and friends. And thank you for the opportunity also. I'm going to talk about heart failure with preserved ejection fraction today. It is a gray area in cardiology and also for a general physician. You see patients with coming with heart failure symptoms, but the cardiologists do an echo and say it is normal ejection fraction. Then you are stuck up with what to do next. So what is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction? It is otherwise called as diastolic heart failure also. It is a syndrome of clinical heart failure where you have symptoms of heart failure, but with no normal left ventricular systolic function in the absence of any cardiac valvular lesions. 30 to 40% of the patients who present with symptoms of congestive cardiac failure will have a normal ejection fraction, and they fall into this category of diastolic heart failure. So whom it is very common is like old age patients who are more than 75 years or 80 years and who have restrictive heart disease, it is more common. So how do you diagnose? Like you need at least some 2-3 things to diagnose the heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. One is the patient should have symptoms and signs of heart failure. And the other thing is, once you do an echocardiogram, the ejection fraction should be normal or should be slightly reduced. That it should be more than 50%. And presence of increased diastolic pressure or impaired filling caused by delayed isovolemic relaxation and elevated increased stiffness of the left ventricle. So there are some controversies in the diagnosis of diastolic heart failure also. So what are the controversies is like whether these patients are have symptoms purely because of diastolic dysfunction. That is the most common controversy. And whether it's really the systolic function is normal. You have an EF of more than 50%. An EF of more than 50% always shows that your systolic function is normal or not. Maybe there may be a subtle LV contractility abnormality that would not be picked up by a normal ejection fraction. Or these patients have an underlying pulmonary disease or any obesity, these contributing to the symptoms of heart failure. So these are the controversies in diastolic heart failure. So what are the difference between a systolic and a diastolic heart failure? The systolic heart failure, the ejection fraction is very low, the stroke volume is low, and the contractility is also very poor. But diastolic heart failure, you have a normal or a slightly decreased ejection fraction, stroke volume, and contractility. And the diastolic function is very abnormal with LV end diastolic pressure that is more increased, and the relaxation time is increased, and the filling rate is normal. The chamber stiffness is very high in diastolic heart failure. In systolic heart failure, the diastolic function may be slightly on the higher side or it may be normal. And the mortality is very much less if you have a systolic heart failure compared to your diastolic heart failure. What is the pathophysiology of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction? First of all, you need two things. One, it should be a thick walled left ventricle which has a small cavity, and that is the ventricle is very stiff and it doesn't relax properly. So these are the main pathology of pathophysiology of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. Because of the thick wall left ventricle, the cavity is very small and this will lead to decrease in the cardiac output. And this low cardiac output leads to fatigue because of the low stroke volume. The stiff left ventricle relaxes very slowly in early diastole and it offers greater resistance to filling in the late diastole. So this leads to elevated diastolic pressures in the left ventricle, and this will be reflected in the left atrium, pulmonary veins and the pulmonary capillaries. And so these patients develop symptoms of exertional dyspnea. As in systolic heart failure, the diastolic heart failure also, there will be neurohumeral activation and there will be tachycardia which will worsen the diastolic heart failure. And these patients will not increase the stroke volume during exercise and they develop symptoms during exercise. So as a usual LV end diastolic volume which increases during exercise will not work in diastolic heart failure. So patients have symptoms on exercise. So what are the predominant contributing factors for diastolic heart failure? The most common thing which we usually commonly see is hypertension. So any patient with hypertension, that is increase in the LV thickness, the ventricles are very stiff and this leads to diastolic heart failure. The most common thing which we see. And then the next one is ischemia. Ischemia will alter the calcium metabolism. And this ischemia along with epicardial coronary artery disease as well as microvascular dysfunction, both of the thing will lead to stiff left ventricle. The other important contributing factor is the heart rate. So any tachycardia or increase in heart rate will reduce the diastole, and this reduction in the diastole will decrease the LV filling time. And this decreased LV filling will lead to decreased cardiac output and elevated diastolic pressures leading to all symptoms. Again, whenever there is elevated LA pressures, again, and there is decrease in the LV filling during diastole, the atria contributes by contracting and then giving an atrial kick. This atrial kick will be lost in atrial fibrillation. So these patients predominantly have more symptoms if they develop an atrial fibrillation. And this ventricular load, which is also less, will also lead to is an important contributing factor. And aging. Aging is because of some collagen depositions and elasticity is lost. Old age patients will have more of diastolic heart failure. So what are the signs and symptoms as already told? So one is dyspnea. Dyspnea is mainly because of the elevated diastolic pressures, elevated LA pressures that is transmitted to the pulmonary capillaries. This will cause dyspnea. And because of the low cardiac output, patient has fatigue and exercise intolerance. The signs which usually we come across is elevated jugular venous pressure, pulmonary rails, and sometimes peripheral edema. Chest X-ray, we may have symptoms of, which we may have findings of pulmonary vascular redistribution, interstitial edema, and sometimes pleural effusions also. So when you have the signs and symptoms, it is very difficult to differentiate between a systolic heart failure and a diastolic heart failure. And echocardiogram plays a very major role in diagnosing diastolic heart failure. So the predominant feature which you see in the, you have a normal LV function, you have an ejection fraction more than 50%, and by eyeballing or other methods, you find like the contractility is normal. And then now you have to make a diagnosis of diastolic dysfunction. The predominant finding for making a diagnosis of diastolic dysfunction is the transmitral flow. You see a normal transmitral flow where it is the E wave, that is the early filling wave, and this is the A wave, which is the late filling because of atrial contraction. This E wave is usually predominant because majority of the LV filling occurs during the early diastolic period, and almost 70% of the blood reaches the left ventricle during the early diastolic period, and the remaining blood is contracted by filled in the left ventricle by atrial contraction, and usually the E wave is larger than the A wave, and the E by A ratio is always more than one. what happens in when you have a stiff left ventricle, which is not relaxing properly, then the left ventricle is not relaxed. So there will not be much filling during the early diastolic period. So the E wave becomes a smaller E wave, and then lot of blood is accumulating in the left atrium. Now the blood has to come to the left ventricle, and the left ventricle has to be filled. Now if it is a normally contracting atrium, the left atrium contracts and the A wave will be more prominent than the E wave, and the E by A ratio is now altered. This is called as grade 1 diastolic dysfunction. And when there is as later, the pressures in the left atrium is very high, so that once the mitral valve opens, there will be opening of the normal opening of the mitral valve, and there will be filling more in the E wave, which is called a pseudo normalization. And this is the severe form of diastolic dysfunction, where you have the pressures are very much elevated and the E wave is more prominent and the A wave is very small. It is a very severe restrictive pattern. Not only this this transmitral flow velocity by Doppler, but you have other parameters by echocardiogram, like the tissue Doppler velocities, which shows the mitral annular motion, and the intramyocardial velocities, which are also decreased during diastolic heart failure. And you have the TAU index, which is an index of myocardial relaxation. This constant is also reduced in diastolic heart failure. The other modalities which we don't use normally is the magnetic resonance myocardial tagging and the radionuclide angiography, which shows like where there are some areas which are not very actively contracting, which may have decreased contractility. But the gold standard is again cardiac catheterization, where you can have a simultaneous pressure of the left ventricle and the left atrium, and you can see what is the pressure levels in the diastole and how is the filling wave in the diastole. So it is the gold standard, but we usually make all the diagnosis only by echocardiogram. Coming to management, since like there is no such specific guidelines or specific things to say like this is diastolic heart failure, you always have a diagnosis like a little bit of exclusion only. So you have the similar way, the management is also not very clear, it is also gray. There is no specific guidelines available for treatment of heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So once you have a patient with diastolic dysfunction, you start treatment early in the phase of diastolic dysfunction itself, not after the patient develops a diastolic heart failure, that is symptoms of heart failure. So as you start early in the early treatment, then the structural changes will not occur and the patient will not slip into a diastolic heart failure. So the treatment goals are predominantly four things. One is reduction of the central blood volume. That is, you give diuretics and then you reduce the central blood volume so that the signs and symptoms of heart failure comes down. And then next is the improvement of the LV relaxation, which can be done with calcium channel blockers or ACE inhibitors. And regression of the LV hypertrophy, this will decrease the thickness as well as remove the excess collagen. This is mainly done by ACE inhibitors and ARBs. And maintenance of atrial contraction and control of the heart rate is done by beta blockers. These four are the mainstay of treatment of diastolic heart failure. So we'll go one by one. Before that, before treating any patient with diastolic heart failure, first there is an underlying condition. You have to treat the underlying condition. So first of all, the most common is hypertension. So hypertension, you can use any drug, what is your preference, or patients, depending upon the patient's comorbidities, you choose a drug so that the hypertension is properly treated and the patient is maintaining a BP of less than 130 by 85 millimeters mercury. And then next comes ischemia. So if you suspect ischemia as a cause for diastolic heart failure, do a coronary angiogram and then look for any epicardial coronary artery disease, and then revascularize the epicardial coronary artery disease. Sometimes patient may have a normal or insignificant coronary artery disease and it may be a microvascular dysfunction which may be contributing to everything. So in that case, put the patient on good beta blockers, good statins and other anti-ischemic drugs and anti-angiogenic drugs also. And then if the patient is having atrial fibrillation is going to worsen the whole situation by having an increase in the heart rate. So aim for rhythm control and maintaining a sinus rhythm. If sinus rhythm could not be maintained or could not be attained, then aim for a rate control. When it comes for rate control, drugs like beta blockers are very very useful for controlling the heart rate, and sometimes we can use digoxin also in these patients. And then obesity is a very important factor. Obesity, you have to make the patient reduce the weight. And then other comorbidities like anemia, diabetes mellitus, and kidney disease should be corrected. Many times, this diastolic heart failure is associated with sleep disordered breathing. So identify the sleep disordered breathing and treat the patient's sleep disordered breathing like OSA. And then these patients may be doing well also. So coming to diuretics, like diuretics, you can use any of the diuretics. It reduces the pulmonary congestion and symptoms of peripheral edema also. But the only problem with using diuretics, it reduces the LV volumes and thereby decreases the cardiac output. Sometimes it leads to hypotension. And in patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or severe left ventricular hypertrophy, it may cause LVOT obstructions, dynamic LVOT obstructions, and thereby cause hypotension. Sometimes the patient may be symptomatic also. So when you use diuretics, you be very cautious in using the diuretics so that the patient is free of symptoms, but at the same time, they don't fall into hypotension or dynamic LVOT obstructions. Coming to the mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, there is a lot of trials showing that mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist has reduced the hospitalization rates. And one among them is the TOPCAT trial, which has shown that spironolactone reduces the number of hospitalizations, even though it does not have any mortality benefit. So start with spironolactone or eplerenone. Spironolactone, start with 12.5 milligrams and titrate to 25 to 50 milligrams daily over a period of 4 weeks. And eplerenone, start with 25 milligrams and increase to 50 milligrams. So the main risk factor or the main thing which you have to watch when you use a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist is you have to see for any dose-limiting hyperkalemia. You cannot start spironolactones if the potassium is more than 4.5. And if it is more than 5, after starting spironolactone, you have to reduce the dose. And if it goes more than 5.5, then you have to stop the mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. And also watch for worsening renal function and hypotension in these patients. The most important drugs which we regularly use is the ACE inhibitors and ARBs. So as ACE inhibitors and ARBs, they reduce the blood pressure. They also cause regression of the LV hypertrophy and improves the elastic properties of the myocardium. These has been tested in many trials like the I-PRESERVE and the CHARM-PRESERVE trial. Everything have shown like there is a significant reduction in the all-cause death and hospitalization. It is significant, but not a major significant benefit. It is a small but significant benefit with candesartan. And the Paragon HF trial, which we already know, like it ARNIs, it had the sacubitril valsartan arm and the regular valsartan arm. And the sacubitril valsartan arm has reduction in the heart failure admissions and death due to heart failure compared to valsartan arm. It was not statistically significant, but there was significant reduction in the symptom class. The other drug is a calcium channel blockers. So attenuating the calcium hemostasis, reducing the blood pressure and promoting LV hypertrophy and regression and slowing the heart rate. Calcium channel blockers helps in reducing the blood pressure and also in promoting the reducing the LV hypertrophy and regression, and thereby it is a very good drug for diastolic heart failure. And it is verapamil is the drug of choice for patients with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. It has been proven in the ELVIRA trial that amlodipine has caused good LV regression over a period of time. Beta blockers improves diastolic function by slowing the heart rate. By slowing the heart rate, the diastole lengthens. And it allows more time for the LV filling and it lowers the LV pressures. Thereby, it improves the LV compliance also. So, in trials, it has found to reduce the LV remodeling and improve the E by A ratio over time. So, it can be used as a first-line drug also. And in patients who have other indications like angina or atrial fibrillation, it will be the first-line drug of choice. It does not provide any mortality benefit from heart failure, diastolic heart failure, as in patients with systolic heart failure, where it may have a reduction in the mortality. The ineffective drugs, I will not say it is an ineffective drug, but you have to use very caution in patients with diastolic heart failure. Nitrates, any nitrates or any predominant venodilators will reduce the preload and thereby reduce the hypotension, will reduce the cardiac output and preload of the heart and thereby causes hypotension. So you have to avoid nitrates in treating patients with diastolic heart failure. And phosphodiesterase inhibitors, sildenafil, may patients with diastolic heart failure over a period of time when they develop pulmonary hypertension, these drugs are not effective and they may cause reduction in the preload and hypotension in these patients. Digoxin is not a primary drug for treatment of diastolic heart failure, but can be used in patients where you have atrial fibrillation for rate control, and sometimes when they go for reduction in the LV function also. What are the other non-pharmacological treatment that is available for diastolic heart failure? The predominant thing is exercise. Like cardiac rehabilitation with exercise definitely reduces the diastolic stiffness and increases the diastolic filling of the heart and thereby improves the symptoms. So definitely like exercise and weight loss both plays a very important role, important non-pharmacological measures for treating patients with diastolic heart failure. The other things which you have to follow is sodium restriction and reduction in alcohol consumption. As treating any patients with heart failure, you should have an annual pneumococcal and influenza vaccination also. So what are the recent advances that's going on? One is the implantable hemodynamic monitoring. It's called as a wireless cardio MEMS pulmonary monitoring device. It has been approved in the US FDA, but it is not available in India and all. It monitors the pulmonary artery pressures and heart rate in patients with New York Heart Association class 3 symptoms who have heart failure symptoms and who have been hospitalized previously. And based on this pulmonary artery pressure and heart rate monitoring, you adjust the medications. So this has reduced heart failure admissions in the CHAMPION trial, but it had 1.5% device-related complications in this trial. The safety of the device needs to be determined by further trials also. And one more device-based therapy is under investigation. It is a device which shunts blood from the left atrium to the right atrium. Once the left atrial pressure increases, the blood is shunted from the left atrium to right atrium and thereby decompresses the left atrium. So the patient's symptom improves, and particularly there is a cardiac hemodynamics improves on exercise. So this device is like doing a septostomy and shunting the blood. So this device is also under investigation. So there are a lot of things yet to come in the market to treat patients with diastolic heart failure. Thank you for the patient listening.
Madam, there is one question from Dr. Sukumar.
Yeah, sir.
Can vibradin be used to reduce heart rate in such patients?
Yeah. Vibradin can be used in... Hello. Hello, can you hear me? Vibradin can be used for patients with heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, but it is not proved, or it has not been proved by trial to use. Vibradin has been studied extensively in heart failure with systolic reduced ejection fraction, but not in preserved ejection fraction. And it cannot be the first line drug also, because the first line drug may be a beta blocker or a calcium channel blocker. And then you can go for vibradin if the heart rate is not controlled.